Victorian Opera acknowledges the traditional custodians of country throughout Australia and their connections to land, sea and community. We pay our respect to their elders past and present and extend that respect to all Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples today.
Hey there, I'm Scott Winfield, and welcome to Victorian Opera's Season 2021 launch. Firstly, I'd like to welcome our Auslan interpreter, Tyson Bowl. Thank you so much for joining us. And indeed, anyone who may be joining us who is blind or visually impaired, I have brown hair and eyes, am wearing a blue shirt, and am smiling at you. I'm delighted to be coming to you live from Victorian Opera's base in Carlton Horty Hall, joined by Victorian Opera's CEO, Elizabeth Hill Cooper.
Hello.
Artistic Director Richard Mills.
Hi.
And our COVID-safe officer who was asleep on the job, Buddy Eleftheriou. Now, before we begin, I'll ask you both to describe yourselves.
Hello, my name's Elizabeth. I have blonde hair, I'm wearing a colourful dress and have bright red lipstick on.
Hello, I'm Richard, middle-aged man with salt and pepper beard, and I'm wearing a black shirt and black trousers.
Now, rather than touch on 2020 too much and risk being swarmed by a plague of locusts live on camera, as entertaining as that would be, let's point our focus to season 2021. Richard, tell us a little bit about your overarching ideas and themes for next year.
This is a season about artists who live and work in this great city. At this time of extraordinary circumstances, it's time to focus on our own family of artists and to enable them to shine, to give of their best as performers and, as importantly, as creators. It's about nurturing the art form through a period of great difficulty, sustaining it so that when these troubled times are ended, it can once again reach its absolute full potential because we've cared for it during this dark time. That's what this season is about.
Now, Elizabeth, we're approaching subscriptions and indeed single tickets a little bit differently next year. What can we expect?
Yes, we've tried to embrace the idea that things will change in 21. Hopefully we'll open up as we are currently doing. So we are selling our season in quarters. You'll be able to purchase tickets to quarter one, there's two productions there, and so forth as we move through the year. The other exciting thing that we're focusing on is three of our wonderful productions throughout the year being available for online content. You can purchase all three now, or you can purchase one or two as you see fit.
Indeed, subscriptions to our first quarter will go on sale at 6:30 p.m. tonight, and they'll be on sale for 2 weeks before single tickets go on sale. But without any further ado, Richard, please tell us what is our first production.
The Sleeping Beauty of Ottorino Respighi. This piece is very apposite to these times we're living in. It was written just after the Spanish flu epidemic. In fact, it was composed during that epidemic. And in fact, poor Respighi suffered a mild case of it. The themes are obvious. It's about renewal, it's about rebirth, and it's about hope. And I think that's a quantity and a quality we need in the world today.
Indeed, Elizabeth, this production features life-sized puppets. Tell us a little bit about it.
So we have seven amazing puppeteers that work with us through Nancy Black's Black Hole Theatre. And really, the singers and the puppets become one. So the singers are the voice for these beautiful life-sized puppets in many instances.
You really couldn't enjoy more magic on stage. And we're going to see a little clip now from our 2017 production, The Chorus of the Stars. Isn't it just exquisite? Please join us for The Sleeping Beauty. It will be performed at the Palais Theatre in St Kilda from the 20th to the 26th of February next year. Now, Richard, similar to Respighi creating work in a time, you know, a pandemic, you've commissioned two new works that speak directly to our times.
Yes, these are Echo and Narcissus by Kevin March and Jane Montgomery Griffiths, and Cassandra by Simon Brookard and Constantine Costi. Myths are stories which tell us about the very great depths of human experience and human nature, the deeper truths of our existence. Echo and Narcissus, of course, is the classic story of the nymph who was forever in love with a beautiful youth who ignored her, becoming self-obsessed with his own image. Cassandra was one of Priam's daughter, a royal house of Troy, and suffered the curse of having the gift of prophecy, but no one believing that gift. So they're both stories that are very apposite to this quite troubled time, and I think provide a platform for two very, very important younger generation composers to write works specifically for the company at this juncture. And it's also going to be directed by the wonderful Sam Strong, who's now a resident of Melbourne, and we're thrilled to welcome Sam to the company.
Indeed, and we have a message from Sam now. Let's take a look.
Hi, my name's Sam Strong, and I have the great privilege of directing a double bill of two brand new operas in Cassandra and Echo and Narcissus. What I think is particularly beautiful about both of these works is that they do what I think opera does best, and indeed maybe only opera can do, and that is to combine the epic and the intimate. The two composer and librettist teams, on Cassandra it is Simon Brookard and Constantine Costi, and on Echo and Narcissus it is Kevin March and Jane Montgomery Griffiths. What those teams have done is preserve the economy and simplicity and compression of the original, but at the same time, they've managed to expand that out into a really rich and vivid and powerful universe. What these two works also do, which I think only opera can do, or opera does particularly well, is combine the timeless and the timely. These are, of course, both stories from classical sources, but somehow they both manage to reach out across time and speak very directly to our current moment. Echo and Narcissus is the original version of what we would now recognise as society's obsession with self-image. Equally, Cassandra is the original story of what we would now describe as speaking truth to power. But I think what is most delicious of all about these two works is how directly they speak to the experience of Melbourne, to the experience of the city in which they will be staged. There's a phrase in one of the operas about a new thing being born from grief's dark ache. That is the experience of the opera, of watching the opera, but it is also, of course, the experience of the city in which the opera will be staged. I'm looking forward to sitting in the playhouse and having the experience of something difficult being transformed into something beautiful. I'm thrilled to be included in Victorian Opera's 15th birthday season. Happy birthday, and I look forward to seeing everyone in 2021. Thank you.
Our double bill of Echo and Narcissus and Cassandra will be performed at Arts Centre Melbourne's Playhouse from the 17th to the 20th of March, and indeed there will be a live stream performance on the 19th. To reiterate, our first two productions, The Sleeping Beauty and our double bill, are on sale from tonight as subscriptions for the next 2 weeks, and then the single tickets will go on sale on the 10th of December. Moving on to quarter two, we're heading outdoors. What's the work?
The Pearlfishers of Bizet. Australia's favourite opera, and an opera which I'm proud to say we can realise absolutely beautifully with our Melbourne colleagues. So it's a great pleasure to present an all-Melbourne cast in this wonderful evening. There'll be lots of mysterious atmosphere. The aspidistras will be out. The crickets may even be singing at the Maya Bowl. Hopefully we don't get a tropical shower, but it'll be an evening to remember. There'll be some magic to be had and to be heard.
Indeed, Richard, you're conducting Orchestra Victoria and Elizabeth, you'll be directing. Who is your cast?
Our cast, we welcome Catherine Radcliffe in the role of Lela. We welcome Stephen Marsh in the role of Zerga, Carlos Ibarsenas as Nadir, and we're very fortunate to have managed to secure Teddy Tahi Roach between engagements to sing the role of Nurabad.
We're delighted now to have a performance from Carlos Ibarsenas and Stephen Marsh, accompanied by Victorian Opera's beloved head of music, Phoebe Briggs, the famous Pearl Fishers duet, of course. To Carlos, Stephen, and indeed Phoebe too. It was wonderful. You can see them perform again next year on the 23rd of April when we present the Pearl Fishers at Arts Centre Melbourne's Sydney Meyer Music Bowl. Now in October, as part of Victorian Opera's 15th birthday celebrations, we announced a First Nations opera by Yorta Yorta soprano and composer Deborah Cheatham, Pa Wong Lifts the Sky. Elizabeth, tell us about this production.
You'll hear from Deborah very shortly, but we're very fortunate to have secured two incredible artists, BJ O'Toole, who will design the cultural designs for the set, and the wonderful Deanne Gilson, who will design the cultural elements for the costumes. They'll be supervised and moved through the construction of the work with our very own Cameron Menzies, who will shortly take up the stewardship at Northern Ireland Opera. So we're very fortunate that we managed to sneak him into it before he takes full control of the company.
Indeed. Now, this production is also presented as part of Victorian Opera's education season. What can we expect from that front?
When we present our education shows, we now have a process that we've been running for over 4 years called Access All Areas, which is a program for regional children outside of the metropolitan zone. They can enlist with the company for a cost of $1 per student to view 4 workshops, which gives them lots of information about the piece, and at the end they will go to the theatre and they will watch a show in their local region.
Wonderful. Now, here is a message from Deborah Cheatham herself.
Hello, I'm Deborah Cheatham, and I'm thrilled to be creating a new work for the 2021 Victorian Opera season. Pa Wong Lifts the Sky is a story that comes from Wadawurrung country, from Ballarat to the Bellarine Peninsula. For 2,000 generations or more, the Wadawurrung people have poured their knowledge and their culture into that land. This story is of Pa Wong, the magpie, who gives to humans the very first sunrise. It's sure to warm your heart. I hope that you'll be there in June 2021 and join us for the world premiere of my new work, Pa Wong Lifts the Sky.
Pa Wong Lifts the Sky will be performed at Art Centre Melbourne in the Playhouse on the 12th of June, which will also be live streamed. There will be a relaxed performance on the 11th of June. Now, we're incredibly excited to present a work that was in Victorian Opera's 2018 season and is already a modern classic. Richard, what's the work?
Backed by popular demand, Lorelei, the tale of the three femmes fatales that lure sailors to death on the rocks by the beauty of their song. But of course, it's much more than that. It's a very complex deconstruction of the Lorelei myth with all sorts of ramifications with feminist dialectic and all of the early 21st century concerns, I think you would say. But at the same time, it's not a didactic piece. It's playful, it's funny, it's also very serious in some spots. So it's quite masterful, in fact.
Elizabeth, tell us about this production, because it was a huge success for Victorian Opera and sold out its original season indeed.
The three girls and Sarah Giles, our director,
yes.
Worked...
Who are our three girls, just very quickly?
Our three girls are Antoinette Halloran, Ali McGregor and Dimity Shepherd.
Indeed.
The rehearsal room was vibrant, I will call it that. There's lots of discussion, there was lots of debate, there was lots of controversy around feelings and opinions, so full of political anxiety and juxtaposition,
yes,
across the board.
Wonderful. Well, we're delighted to have a performance now from Ali, Antoinette and indeed Dimity, accompanied by Phoebe as well. Let's take it away.
Excited to be bringing Lorelei back to Melbourne in 2021.
And this year our new home will be by the sea, as it should be, at the beautiful Palais Theatre in St Kilda.
Remember, we sold out last time, so when tickets go on sale, get yours in a hurry.
Thank you to Phoebe, Ali, Antoinette, and indeed my distant cousin Dimity. Fun fact. Lorelei will be performed at the Palais Theatre from the 29th of June to the 2nd of July. Now, moving on to our third quarter for 2021. Richard, we're presenting an Australian opera that has not been performed since 1990, and this is of huge significance. What's the work?
Voss by Richard Mille, David Malouf, after Patrick White. A seminal Australian work which defined the investigation of Australian identity in the 80s. With a remarkable score to a remarkable literary document that David Malouf has fashioned from the epic novel of Patrick White. So this will be presented in association with a series of events, of colloquiums, of seminars around White, around Malouf and around Mille, coordinated by Vincent Plush in association with the Wheeler Centre and the University of Melbourne. More details later, fine print, but it will be an event of national significance and something of which we are very proud. Additionally, we have the most gracious permission of Lynn Williams to create a scenography from the paintings of the great Fred Williams to exemplify the interior of Australia.
Elizabeth, who else is involved in this production?
We're working with the State Opera of South Australia. So the director for this piece is Stuart Maunder. We're also very lucky to have an operatic debut for Victorian Opera from Emma Pearson singing the role of Laura and Samuel Dundas singing the role of Voss.
Wonderful. And Richard, you'll be conducting the Australian National Academy of Music, which is always an extraordinary collaboration for Victorian Opera. Voss will be performed at the Palais Theatre on the 4th of August, and indeed this performance will also be live streamed as well. Now, a year later than planned, Victorian Opera will stage the Australian premiere of The Who's Tommy, the five-time Tony Award-winning rock musical. What can we expect, Elizabeth?
Well, we're so grateful that we could present this work after having it postponed from 2020. We've managed to keep most of the cast, almost up to 90%, and nearly all of our creative team. Unfortunately, we've lost our MD to Hamilton, but she's gone to great ground.
Indeed. Well, we're delighted to have a message from our leading man, Matt Verovis.
Hello, Matt Verovis here. I'm so excited to be a part of Victorian Opera's incredible 2021 season. I think Melbourne is going to absolutely love The Who's Tommy. It's a story unlike anything that has come before and after it. And honestly, I'm just really excited to get down there and start rehearsing and rock out with you all on opening night. See you soon.
Join us at the Palais Theatre from the 13th to the 21st of August. It's going to be epic. I really think so. Now, Richard, fresh from your success in South Australia, albeit only one performance, of your opera, The Summer of the 17th Doll, your very first opera, You're composing a new one. What's that?
The Butterfly Lovers by Joel Tan, a wonderful Singaporean poet, to be directed by one of the great theatre makers of Asia, Ivan Heng, from Singapore's Wild Rice Company. And this will be a co-production with the Singapore International Festival of Arts in 1920.
We are going back in time.
2022. and it's a chamber opera with just three people in it and a chorus of eight, which deals with myth, another myth. There's a great scattering of myth throughout our year. These stories that tell us something very deep about ourselves. And this is a famous Chinese story of two young people who fall in love, but whose love is forbidden by a very prescriptive patriarchy. I mean, you could almost say it's on the evening news these days, that prescriptive patriarchy from our northern neighbours. But anyway, they transcend it in the only way they know how, by falling into his other's arms, dying, and being transformed by the gods into butterflies, where they live eternally, happily, away from the stress of mortal existence. It's a perfect subject for an opera. And interestingly, it will have two Chinese instruments as well as a small chamber orchestra. Dizi, the Chinese flutes, and pipa, the Chinese lute.
Wonderful. Now we have a message from Ivan Heng. Let's take a look.
Hi, I'm Ivan Heng, founder and artistic director of Wild Rice, a leading Singapore theatre company. I'm absolutely thrilled to be collaborating with Richard Mills and Victorian Opera on the world premiere of Butterfly Lovers. This is all the ingredients of a wonderful new opera. It's about forbidden love, family, society, and we're going to spice it up by taking a look at gender and sexuality. We have been thinking very much of how it would appeal to audiences in Australia and in Singapore and indeed around the world, and we can't wait to share it with you.
The Butterfly Lovers will be performed at Arts Centre Melbourne's Playhouse from the 13th to the 16th of November. Now, Elizabeth, Victorian Opera is presenting two final works in our season, which are both great celebrations of our emerging talent. What's the first one?
Our youth opera programme for 2021 is The Friends of Salamanca. Again, our second of our postponed shows from 2020. But this was the inaugural season where we were going to create our youth orchestra for the first time, so we wanted to continue that and pledge our needs for that desire to really educate those musicians, the younger musicians of Victoria.
Wonderful. The Friends of Salamanca will be performed at Arts Centre Melbourne's Playhouse from the 19th to the 20th of November. Now, Richard, as our final production for 2021, we're collaborating with an extraordinary Australian opera singer.
Yes, the Lisa Gastein National Opera Programme. This actually grows very nicely out of the Schubert opera, The Friends of Salamanca, to an opera by Otto Nicolai, Die Lustigen Weiber von Windsor, The Merry Wives of Windsor, which is, of course, based on the Falstaff story from the Shakespearean history plays, and this extraordinary character. So much fun, and it's you have a gentle smile on your face all night. It's so beautiful, and it's a perfect vehicle for young people. And I come back again to what I said at the beginning. Our aim, our purpose in 2021, as part of our mission to reimagine the potential of opera for everyone, is to ensure that our practitioners of this art are sustained and enabled to share their gifts with us, to transport us, to take us to magic places, to nourish our souls, where possible, in the theatre and practice their craft, so that the light and the passionate flame which burns in this company is not extinguished but is kept going and nourished by this great team of people with whom I have the immense good fortune and privilege to share my life with.
Thank you very much, Richard. We're delighted to have this message from Lisa Gastein.
Hello, Melbourne. I'm Lisa Gastein from the Lisa Gastein National Opera Program. I'm really excited that in 2021, the program is coming to Melbourne. We're collaborating with Richard Mills and Victorian Opera. And for me, this is very exciting to be returning to Melbourne in an operatic capacity, because As a singer, I used to have so much fun and enjoyed very much my performing in Melbourne. So it's a very valuable experience for our young singers to work with such a prestigious and well-regarded opera company in their own country. So we're looking forward to seeing you, and we'll be performing Die lustigen Weiber von Windsor by Otto Nicolai, and I think you'll enjoy it.
The Merry Wives of Windsor will be performed at Melbourne Recital Centre's Elizabeth Murdoch Hall on the 3rd and 4th of December. Now that concludes season 2021. Congratulations.
Well, congratulations to everybody, to our great team, to Libby, to you, to the wonderful people at Victorian Opera, and to our sponsors and the people who sustain us on a daily basis through this difficult time.
Indeed. I must say congratulations to you both as well for your immense stewardship and care for our industry throughout such a tumultuous year, and I think you both deserve a hearty pat on the back.
Thank you.
Thank you, Scotty.
Now, as noted earlier, Victorian Opera's first quarter goes on sale tonight. That includes The Sleeping Beauty and our double bill. Subscriptions will be on sale for 2 weeks, and then our single tickets go on sale on the 10th of December. As well, as noted throughout our live stream, Voss, Pa Wong Lifts the Sky and our double bill will all be live streamed throughout the season. They are available as a subscription package or individually. You can find more details at victorianopera.com.au. Victorian Opera is able to share the joy of music, and indeed opera, thanks to many, many important people. The Australia Council for the Arts, the State Government of Victoria through Creative Victoria, and our long-standing foundation partnership with the Robert Seltzer Foundation. Indeed, our immense thanks to our corporate partners, our patrons, and our trusts and foundations. Richard and Elizabeth, congratulations again. I must also say thanks to Tyson Bowl, our Ausland interpreter, our wonderful performers, and our technical crew. Thank you so much for joining us, and good night.